Hello, my name is Deep Saini. I'm the President and Vice-chancellor of Dalhousie University, and you are watching The Deep Dive. In this episode of The Deep Dive, I speak with the Dean of Dalhousie's newly renamed Faculty of Open Learning and Career Development, Dr. Dianne Tyers, along with Ms. Krista Brodie, a former student of the faculty and now a member of its governing council. Joining them is Dr. Arvind Gupta, who is an accomplished academic and higher education administrator who is now leading a national initiative to rapidly upskill workers from disrupted industries. We discuss the future of retraining and continuing education in an evolving world. Please join me in welcoming my next guest, Dr. Arvind Gupta, Dr. Dianne Tyers, and Ms. Krista Brodie. So good morning, Arvind, Krista, and Dianne. It is such a pleasure to see you here. And Arvind, my apologies to you to especially wake you up at such an early hour of the morning. I know that you are in Vancouver, but thank you so much for joining us. It is such a pleasure to have you all here. Well, you know, this conversation is triggered by a name change of our College of Continuing Education to the Faculty of Open Learning and Career Development. And, you know, open learning, career development, skills development, that is a hot subject these days. And there's a lot of talk about this, not just within Dalhousie, but nationally and internationally. And Arvind, you have been at the forefront of this conversation. You know, you've been the force behind the creation of Palette Skills, which is a national platform for rapid upskilling of workers that have been affected by the pandemic. In fact, it was created before the pandemic, but it came in really handy during the pandemic. And let's begin by you telling us a little bit more about Palette and your role in it and what you hope to accomplish with it.
Yeah, thank you, Deep. Real pleasure to be here and to be celebrating the new faculty of open learning. I think it's very timely to do this rebranding and repositioning. So I think it's important to understand why we felt it was important to create Palette. And this goes to the heart of the rapid evolution of our economy. We see that nearly every sector is now being disrupted by automation and new technologies. And so in some sense, every sector is becoming a knowledge sector. And that's creating an interesting dynamic where we have significant labor market shortages appearing right across the economy, even while our unemployment rate is not that low, but even our more interesting labor market participation rates are not that high. So we know there's considerable slack in the economy. We know that people are being disrupted, and yet we see all these shortages appearing in the economy. So what did we set out to do? We set out to understand at a granular level what skills are needed in the economy. We then want to understand how to involve industry in an upskilling paradigm and pedagogy, and somewhat similar to what the Germans and the Belgium do in the apprenticeship program. We want to create upskilling programs that leverage people's skills, pre-existing skills, whether education or work experience. Sometimes this is framed as a micro-credentialing issue, but you want to build upskilling programs that start where people already are and then take them from there up. And then finally, you have to create transition pathways for them. Many of the people you'll upskill come from legacy industries where they've been displaced. In the pandemic, that was tourism, hospitality, retail, and figure out a way to move them into where the economy is growing. So Palette was really designed to understand these issues and then create new pedagogies that address them.
Arvind, thank you for that intro, and it couldn't have been more timely. And I am making a safe assumption that this is gonna remain timely and current for quite some time to come. And speaking of timeliness, Dianne, the decision of your faculty to change its name to the Faculty of Open Learning and Career Development is not accidental. There's a strategy behind it, and it reflects the rapid evolution of the college to this faculty. Could you tell us a little bit more about what has been the driving thought behind this evolution, and where do you see the faculty going?
Yeah, thanks, Deep. Yeah, we're very excited to have made this change, and it's not just a name change, as you say. It's also a strategy change. to really align with the trends that Arvind identified, just very, very rapid change in the labor market and in the economies. So when we went looking for a new name, we were kind of thinking of three things. The first thing was we wanted a name that captured the full range of learning experiences that we offer. So we offer everything from support to get access to university studies, to early career support, mid-career support, support in retirement even. And so we needed a name that captured that whole range of learning experiences that we offer. And then the second thing that we wanted our name to signal is the word access. And we felt the word open really did that for us, because we want our learning to be accessible to anyone. Because throughout our lifetimes, everyone needs those learning experiences. So the word open really signals the accessibility of the learning that we offer. And then the final thing we were looking for is also what Arvind pointed out, is we needed a name that was future-oriented, because the sector that we operate in, the lifelong learning sector, it's undergoing massive change and very rapid change. And so we wanted a name that signaled we're there with everyone and with all of our learners as they navigate that rapid change.
So that's very well put, Dianne. And I am predicting actually that this faculty is going to be, the name is going to be shortened in daily use to just simply Faculty of Open Learning.
Yes.
Krista, speaking of open learning, you have had a very interesting journey in your partnership with this faculty, which is kind of, you know, almost lifelong partnership. You have come through a transition to your program. And so you're an alumna of the College of Continuing Education, and now you serve on the governing council of the faculty. You know, in that role, you've seen this open learning concept in its evolution. So what does open learning mean to you?
Well, that's a great question. The Faculty of Open Learning and Career Development is near and dear to me because it actually changed my entire life. I started off in restaurant management. I kind of hit my ceiling. I was in desperate need of change just for my own contentment. And TYP was suggested. I went through the program, completed it. I'm now a Dalhousie, fourth year Dalhousie student studying political science, minoring in Indigenous studies. And what it's this program has done for me is just opened up many pathways of learning, of career choice. I find myself with too many options now. So I'm very, very, very grateful for the program and the development of it.
So Krista, that was very heartwarming to hear, you know, the impact that this faculty or its precursor has had on you. And I know that you're not just simply a student, you are also raising a family as you are being a student. And that's also very much part of the ethos of this faculty. So we have it right at Dalhousie. We have it right at the national level. I think we're thinking about the right things. But let's come to the present times. You know, these issues that you three of you have highlighted are important at any time, but I don't recall, at least in my life, when they have been more important than they are today as we are navigating our way through and eventually hopefully out of this pandemic. And Dianne, let me ask you, what has going through the pandemic and heading this faculty that is focused on open learning and career development meant to you? And how has the faculty created a meaning for itself in the minds of those who use the services of this faculty?
Yeah, thanks, Steve. I just want to go back to something Krista said before I answer your question, actually. I loved hearing, Krista, that you have too many choices for pathways moving forward. That to me is a wonderful problem for you to have, actually. So that's really exciting. Yeah. Anyway, going to your question, Deep. We as soon as the pandemic hit, we just kicked into high gear, which, you know, which happened in every faculty across every university, literally all over the world. But we had a particular focus in terms of what we were trying to do and where we put our time and energy. And the first thing we wanted to do was to make sure that our programming was accessible to as many people as possible. So we just did a very, very rapid switch to online, which basically everyone had to do. But then the next thing we did is we looked at our entire range of programming, and we focused on the programming that we thought would help people navigate the pandemic most strategically and most successfully. And we call these our career essentials courses. And so we created this bucket, and we put all of the courses we currently had into this bucket and called these our career essentials courses. And we promoted these as courses that would really help people navigate the massive change that the pandemic created for everyone. And then we took a very strategic look at where we could create new initiatives that would really help and be impactful in the community and with our community of learners. And so the first thing we did is we launched micro-credentialing. And I'm sure everyone's heard the term micro-credentialing. It's kind of a buzzword right now. But what we did is we tried to take our existing programming and also new programming that were smaller chunks of learning that would address immediate labor market needs and really help people upskill and pivot very quickly. So we're very pleased with where our micro-credentialing initiative is at right now. We finished the pilot phase, and we're moving on to our second pilot, where we'll be adding more and more programming to the micro-credentialing. So that's a really exciting piece that we added directly as a result of the pandemic. Another piece we've added is an initiative around prior learning assessment, because once again, to help people pivot quickly in today's world, they actually have to have a really good understanding of what their current skill set is. And a lot of people don't understand that with the work experience they've already had. So for example, Krista, you mentioned you were a restaurant manager. That brings with it an enormous set of skills, but there's no way to recognize them. So we're creating prior learning assessment to help people understand and recognize the skills they already have, and then how those can apply in the current labor market. And then another very practical thing we did is we launched a portfolio around health and wellness. The pandemic really brought to the forefront our need to take care of ourselves, because it is very, very stressful times. And so we've shifted this focus of some of our programming onto how do we help people and give them the knowledge and the strategies to take care of themselves so that they can actually navigate the pandemic in a healthy way. And then the final thing that we did is we took a look across the whole university, and every faculty just put 100% of their effort into creating really rich online learning experiences for their learners. And we felt very strongly that some of these learning activities and learning experiences would actually be of interest to the general public and would also help the general public experiment and try out university learning experiences. So we've got an initiative underway called Dal Open, where we're partnering with different faculties to get some of their programming available to the general public so they can try out different subject matter and just try themselves out in a university degree type learning experience. So it's been a really exciting time for us. I know it's been really stressful for everyone and stressful for us as well, but we really did try to step up and get initiatives underway that would really help our learning communities navigate the pandemic.
And that's at the level of a university and the community that surrounds us. That's where, you know, primarily your services are provided. So let me zoom out from there to the national level where Arvind operates. And Arvind, development of palette skills has been, you know, underway since before pandemic arrived, or we even thought about that there would be a pandemic. It had entirely different purposes. So, you know, that's forward thinking on the part of you and others who were involved with you. But then comes the pandemic. And can you give us some sense of the kind of activities that are pandemic specific that Palette is engaged in, and some examples of the successes that you are already having? And I know that they are impressive already.
Yeah, thank you. And really interesting to hear all the things that Dalhousie has been doing during the pandemic. So we started our first programming 8 months before the pandemic in Toronto, and we had a small amount of pilot funding from the federal government. We showed about 96% placement rates into tech sales, mainly taking people out of places like retail employment. When the pandemic hit, of course, it disrupted our plans, a little bit scary, but we thought we'd do something very bold. We went into the two regions of Ontario with the highest unemployment on numbers, Windsor and Durham. And we said, let's run our programs there. So in October of last year, we ran our tech sales program. So this is a program to move people into technology sales. 80% of our participants had not worked since March. And many of the companies we dealt with said, you know, we're not really hiring. We were shocked at 100% placement. Every person we brought into our program got placed right away. We replicated the program in Durham this March, and it looks like we're going to get 100% or very close to 100% placement in Durham as well. So this really taught us that first, there's a really great pool of talent out there. Often talent is unappreciated because it doesn't have the right experience label. If you're coming out of retail, hospitality, tech companies don't necessarily see you as the kind of worker they'd hire on. And they're all looking for 3 to 5 years experience in the tech sector. And yet the experience these people have is highly relevant. It's exactly what Dianne said, right? That you have to contextualize their experience and show that it's relevant to where the employers want to hire. At the same time, we started hearing from a lot of companies that the new modality they're in, all this remote work, has really boosted the demand for cybersecurity. So we decided to just launch a cybersecurity program, partnered with the Fields Institute, which is a mathematics institute with lots of experience, and created this program in 3 months. And again, saw very good outcomes. One of the big things we learned during the pandemic is how important, whether you call it soft skills, professional skills, I call it humanistic skills, how important those skills are, how important it is to be able to show that you can work in a team, how important it is to show that you find a way to get to a yes when you see a challenge, you find a way to think outside the box when something new is thrown at you. And recognizing how important those skills are, we've then put a lot more emphasis on integrating them into all our programming. The next step for Pallet is to expand nationally and to build both the current set of programming nationally, but also look at regional programming needs. And in Atlantic Canada, we are in talks with Dalhousie, UNB, a number of business associations about looking at how we can take what we've learned in Ontario and then take regional differences in what's happening with the with companies in Atlantic Canada and revise these programs so that they work for local companies here and for the population base here. So we're very excited about that and really looking forward to working with you, Deep, and your team.
So Arvind, thank you for that. And it is so nice to be sitting here talking about this relationship between Pallet and Dalhousie, which as you know, is very much part of Pallet now. And we're looking forward to what differences we will make here in Atlantic Canada. There is a history of initiatives that start in Toronto, flourishing here in Atlantic Canada. And one example that comes to my mind is the Creative Destruction Lab that started at the University of Toronto and has flourished here as CDL Atlantic. And I'm looking forward to the same kind of relationship between Pallet and Dalhousie University. So with that, let me turn to Krista here as one last question to you, Krista, to wrap it up. You have had a very interesting relationship, as I said earlier, with College of Continuing Education and now with Faculty of Open Learning, where you started as an alumna and then you became a member of the governing board of the faculty and many things in between. I see this, this voluntary position that you have with the board now as essentially your way of paying it forward. Am I making the right assumption? And if I am, tell me a bit more about what went through your mind as you decided to devote your time to serving on the board.
Yes, you are absolutely correct. It is my way of giving back and paying it forward. For me, as a mature student, all of these incentives are great, but if we don't come to participate in the incentives, then, they're really, pointless. So for me, I want to show that you can do this. If I can do this as a, you know, a mature student, raising a family, you know, in the middle of a pandemic, so can you. And I think the hardest decision for me was to make that change. You know, when I was emerged in life, you know, sometimes it's hard to detangle yourself from doubt, from fear, from, you know, all those things that, you know, I've kind of piled up on you. But when you can see the opportunity clearly, you know, and it's put forth before you in a way that you know that you can attain it, and there's support systems in place to help you get through it, that to me is why I'm a part of the Governing Council, because I want people to see that you can make a change. You know, whatever it is you want to do, it's possible. So,
yeah, thank you, Krista. And speaking of change, you know, I'm looking at three change makers here. You know, pandemic will come to an end, and there are good signs that it is coming to an end here, at least in Canada. But there is a fear that economic consequences of it would linger with us for quite some time to come. And three of you, in your own ways, are involved in helping mitigate the impacts of those economic consequences on our people. And I can't think of a nobler thing to do at this moment than what you're doing. So thank you very much, not only for participating in this conversation, but for doing what you do. This is truly transformative for our society. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us on this episode of The Deep Dive. Please don't forget to like this video, subscribe to our channel, and share this video. Until the next time, I'm Deep Saini, and this has been The Deep Dive.